या गुड मॉर्निंग सुष्मिता। ओके सो वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न टुडे अबाउट नो एसक्यूएल। दैट इज द थर्ड चैप्टर इन योर सिलेबस। ओके नो सिक्वेल, सम पीपल से नो सिक्वेल, नो एसक्यूएल डेटाबेसेस। ओके इट इज सो वी जस्ट ओके आई थिंक द स्क्रीन इज विजिबल टू यू। सो वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न अबाउट नो सिक्वल डेटाबेसेस टूडे। एज पर द सिलेबस देर आर फोर टाइप्स ऑफ नो सिक्वल डेटाबेसेस। करंटली देर आर अराउंड मोर देन 400 और मे बी मोर देन दैट नो सिक्वल डेटाबेसेस आर अवेलेबल। Okay, and the NoSQL databases are getting very popular because of the size of the data or big data. And RDBMS is not sufficient to do the analytics or to store such a big amount of data. So that's why NoSQL databases got introduced. And there are a variety of databases that people are creating. It may be more than 400. We are studying four main types of databases, NoSQL databases, which are famous. And they got invented in the beginning and used by the popular organizations. Okay, as per the syllabus, there is a case study also in the syllabus. Okay, so this is what is the objective for this particular chapter. I'll not be able to cover everything in today's lecture. In today's lecture, we will see what is the background, what are the problems of RDBMS, what are the issues, what is a distributed system. So this is a background, like what is to create a background about studying this NoSQL. Like what is RDBMS, what are the issues, what is SCID properties, and in case of distributed systems, what are the goals of distributed system. This is not with respect to database, but distributed system, any distributed system where you store your information in the distributed manner, or if you want to process the information or in a distributed manner. So a distributed system ka goals that we will see in this particular topic of background. Okay, like we get the current real world scenario, and in that, with respect to this real world scenario, RDBMS is not suitable and NoSQL. So there was no way, and people had to invent NoSQL databases. Okay, the nowadays because of the distributed system and this and some other factors, it was necessary to invent NoSQL databases to perform some of the operations which are needed for big data analytics. And as NoSQL is not following this SCID properties, there is something called as Bayes theorem and CAP theorem, like where Bayes theorem or CAP theorem. So so we'll see what is CAP theorem. In the exam they ask for CAP theorem also. And then what are the business drivers, like how the big volume, velocity, variability and agility is affecting and has forced to come up with NoSQL databases, or all these factors, they force the programmers to use NoSQL databases instead of RDBMS. So this is about the business drivers. And then there are case studies. These are four case studies that we are going to see. Amazon DynamoDB is a key value store. Okay, actually there are two types of questions which are asked here, that what are the different categories. So these are the four different categories, and these are the four examples. So even even if you take some other example, that is also fine. But I'm taking as per the textbook. These are the four examples for these four data stores. Okay, so are you understanding what I'm talking right now? I'm talking about what is this what is there in this particular chapter of NoSQL databases. In NoSQL databases, we are going to learn the difference between RDBMS, problems of RDBMS, then why NoSQL databases are needed to be invented, what are the factors of big data characteristics that forced us to work with NoSQL databases, what are the different types of NoSQL databases, that is key store, column store, document store, graph store, and these are the examples. DynamoDB, Amazon uses DynamoDB, that is key value. HBase is a column store by Hadoop. MongoDB is a document store, and Neo4j is a graph store example. So I have selected these four examples. to study in detail about the category and how NoSQL uses to manage, means what are the different techniques that NoSQL databases are using to manage with big data. So this way we are going to learn, okay, in this chapter. So this everything is not possible in one lecture. I may need 4 to 5 lectures to cover this topic. For one case study, I have planned one lecture for one case study. Actually, one case study is itself a subject to learn. But as per the scope of this, because I have to complete the syllabus also. So depending on the questions which are asked in the exam, I have planned that one lecture per case study. Okay, and in the exam they asked around 10 marks of question on NoSQL databases. Every paper 10 marks of question. Okay, so I think you have understood what is the objective for today. Objective is understanding RDBMS problems, NoSQL databases, CAP theorem, business drivers, and if time permits, then understanding how NoSQL databases is going to use manage big data. Okay. I think you can hear me.
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
You are understanding, no, Silla? Or
yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we started with the new chapter, relational algebra part. We will see in whenever I get a time of 15 minutes, because it needs only last 15 minutes to cover up. So I'll again touch up with the relational algebra pseudocode in one of the lectures at the end. Okay, so today I'm starting with the new topic, that is NoSQL databases. So what is relational database management system? Relational database management system, mostly it concentrates on structured data. Your data is in the form of tables. Everyone knows there are rows and columns and fixed structure is there. So every row has a fixed number of columns. Even if sometimes, like now in real world, suppose you are storing the information about the customer, because customer is very important. Everywhere, everyone is capturing the customer data. If you are working on WhatsApp, if you are on Instagram, where people are posting their pictures a lot and they are writing something, all this information is used. We don't know, they like, we are not aware our pictures are used by Instagram, and they are they may be having a system such as face recognition system where they need millions or billions of photographs of different Instagram people, or they are using it. Okay, so that their face recognition system needs a huge data set, and it is a neural network or deep learning kind of application which needs many data items to go through to learn properly. Okay, so in such kind of applications, what is needed is that we don't need all the columns for all the customers. Sometimes in real world, what happens is that for a particular customer, we need some extra column. But other customers, we don't need the extra column. And if that is the requirement, then in case of RDBMS, you are having a fixed number of columns for every row. And if you want to update the table, then you are going to add a new column. And that column ka value will remain blank or null for the other records. And it is a wastage of space. And the size of the data is huge. And only few records ke liye we are adding a new column. So it is a structured, so there is no flexibility in RDBMS. But RDBMS is also important because our business operations, it is best suitable for transactions. Like here I'm writing a very transactional across the tables. So it is a transactional database. Wherever there is a transaction, if you want to fire a query like fire a query such as what is a particular product detail or something like that, then a transactional query, then this database is needed because of its own properties. So it is not going, like it will not be away from this computer field. RDBMS will also be there, but we need extra capacity databases to perform the analytics. So for analytics kind of queries, we need NoSQL databases, where RDBMS is not at all suitable. But for transactional systems where we are firing some kind of query, which is not an analytics query, then in that case RDBMS is also needed. Okay, so RDBMS became famous because e-commerce applications whenever you want to perform any write operation and update something about the total number of products or available products now after selling, such kind of things. So we need RDBMS, and it is popular, it is commonly used, but it is initially designed for non-distributed system. So the main design of RDBMS is not with respect to the distributed system. They have not considered about the distributed system when they invented RDBMS. Okay, and nowadays the low cost alternatives are also available, and open source databases are also available. MySQL, SQLite, Postgres, these are low cost alternatives, and people can easily use them, and they can develop their website or e-commerce site or their project by using RDBMS database in the background. But whenever there is any transactional kind of command, then it can be used. But when even it can be used somewhere wherever your data is distributed. Okay, sometimes if you want to distribute the data, so distributed databases are also there, where you can horizontally distribute your RDBMS ka table across multiple machines. Okay, means horizontal distribution or vertical distribution. Horizontal distribution means, suppose I am having a table where the records of my employees are there, and I am having multiple locations of my office. My one of the branches in Mumbai, one of the branches in Bangalore, one of the branches in US. So my table can be horizontally partitioned. It can be horizontally distributed with respect to the location. And the people who are sitting in Mumbai office will see all the records of the employees of Mumbai. It may happen that the replicas are there, and they, if they want, they can access. But the database can be distributed. What I'm trying to say here is that it is not initially designed for non-distributed. It is initially designed for non-distributed systems, but it is not for distributed systems. Its original design is not for distributed system, but still we can distribute whenever we need, but at a cost. Okay, so it is costly. It is not easy, and lots of tamjam is there. Like you have to see the location, then Mumbai location records will reside in a server on Mumbai. And Bangalore related records will reside on a server, database server, which is there in the Bangalore ka office, or US ka koi New Jersey ka jo office hai, uska records will remain at New Jersey database server. So you have to divide the table into different partitions, and that tables are residing at different locations. And so that whenever you're firing a query sitting at Mumbai for some Mumbai people, it's faster. But then the firing a query for Bangalore by sitting here in Mumbai will take time. Okay, so that way people are trying and they are doing it, but it is costly. And this is horizontal distribution, like all the rows are available at a particular location. That is horizontal distribution of the database. Vertical distribution of database means some of the columns are residing at one location and some of the columns are residing at another location. Your table may have 10 columns, 5 columns. All the records are residing at one database server, and the remaining 5 columns with all the rows are residing at another database server. Okay, so this way we can do the distribution of RDBMS, but it is not easy and it is at a cost. Okay, so because they are not initially designed for a distributed system, okay, it is not thought of the designers. Designers thought that there will be a server which is a high capacity server where you can keep entire database, even you can gather the data from all the locations, and it is going to reside at a single database server. Okay, because when we write a program, what we do is that we write a program in Java, and your data database is created on a particular server. In multi-tier architecture or in three-tier architecture, you have a client. And the application server and the database server. And application server may your business logic is running. At the client side, the client logic is running. That GUI part is running at the client side. And your application is running at the application server in the form of components. And then your database is residing at the end as a database server. So we have it is not designed for a distributed system. Original design is not for distributed, so it is not that suitable for that. Plus, there is some other problem of RDBMS. Like we are thinking, and that is right for transactional problems, that we do the normalization techniques, and then we normalize and we use multiple joins, and the tables are and are interrelated to each other. But see, whenever there is any join, or if there are any, then your outer join kind of queries, or nested queries, queries within the query, or if it is something, some high level programming at the database side, then it is not easy. Like it takes time. It takes time to execute. If your outer join is there, or if the nested query is there, if you wire and you are calling that, or you are writing something in your program to execute that query takes lots of time to execute compared to the normal select query. So your query becomes complex, and it takes time. And if your data is size is manageable, then you can wait for that particular time. But if your data is big, then firing such a query may take 1 or 2 days of time, and that is not at all allowed in case of real world applications. Okay, so the problem of RDBMS, another problem is that it supports joins. So that is suitable for transactional kind of systems, but it is not suitable for analytics kind of systems. Having such a complicated joins and complicated queries are not suitable for analytics kind of queries. And always for RDBMS, our data should be structured, and it is always predictable. We know exactly what kind of structure is there in the data. And in real world, for analytics, we have the unstructured data. Okay? So RDBMS does not offer best solution for all scenarios of application. It is suitable only for few transactional kind of applications. Okay? So what we have, just we can summarize here, what we are saying is that RDBMS is originally designed for non-distributed systems. It is suitable for business transactional kind of operations. Even if the small, low-cost databases are available, they are not distributed, and if you want to distribute it horizontally or vertically, you can somehow manage, but it will not work for a big data set, a big data kind of application when the size of the data grows, and it is costly also. Distribution of RDBMS is costly, and because of the joins or normalization operations, whenever you are firing any query, it takes lots of time. Okay. So it is not at all suitable for all kinds of application. It is suitable for some kind of application. It will be there in the market. People will still use RDBMS, but for analytics, it is not suitable. Okay. And nowadays, why NoSQL is needed? Because of the explosion of data. Data is continuously increasing, and it's a big data, which we have seen about it in the first lecture. Okay. So if it is a big data, normally nowadays, whenever we write the program, we use the object relational kind of programming, where what we do is that suppose you are having a employee table, then what we do in the Java program, when we are accessing that employee table, you create an object of employee. Okay, and we fire the query, select query on the employee table, we fetch the record, and that record is in the form of an object. So it is object relational mapping is used, or with some advanced techniques or frameworks such as Hibernate or some other techniques, we can create a table, and for the table corresponding classes are there. And we map our class with the relational database. And whenever we fire the query, automatically the data will be retrieved in the form of an object of a Java. And then that object you can use in your program. So this this is not flexible. Suppose your database is changed, then again you need to change the code also. Okay, somewhere you will have to do some kind of changes in the program also. So RDBMS may normalization and joins are powerful, but not for analytic kind of query, and they are cost. They result in costly, complex objects. Okay, and the rows are expensive to handle in that case. Okay, so the another hurdle is the size of the data, and object relational mapping kind of programming is there, which is not flexible because of the mismatch of the objects. Okay. Now, we observe that in relational database management system, we follow SCID rules. Okay. SCID rules are that a database transaction must be atomic, consistent, isolated, and durable. That you must be knowing because you've studied database management systems. Okay. So any RDBMS, it follows all these four rules. Like the transaction, whenever any transaction is happening, the transaction should be atomic. The transaction should be atomic means it should be either completed properly or none of the transaction is performed. So either it is rollback or it is committed. The transaction is a logical unit of work which should be committed or it should be rollback, or either one of them will happen. It will be completed properly. And if the system is not able to complete it, it will roll back the transaction. So the transaction should be atomic. Okay, that is the property of database. Relational database management systems. Then here the another requirement is that consistent. At the end of the consistency should be there. At the end of the transaction, all the data should be left in a consistent state. So it should give you the same view over across multiple locations. Okay. Even if matlab RDBMS we are using a single database servers, but the single database servers ka mirrors are created. So the data is replicated in RDBMS kind of websites. The data based servers are replicated. That is also possible because otherwise it will not give you the fast results. So the databases are replicated. So multiple database servers are residing at multiple locations, and they are connected with very high speed connection in such a way that if you replicate the data, consistency should be there because multiple copies of the data is residing. And if you change the copy at one place, another copy should also be reflected within the fractions of seconds, so that the same view should be there for all the users for the data. Okay, so the consistency is needed in case of RDBMS. It follows and it provides you a proper consistency, and this is the requirement. Even the another requirement is that at the end of the transaction, all the users should see the same view of the data. So database should remain in the consistent state. Then the third property is about isolated. Okay, so any transaction that is performed, it should be independent of other transactions. So like it should not affect the other side of your application. Okay, so the modification of the data performed by the transaction must be independent of other transactions. If multiple transactions are happening, then one transaction should not interfere with another transaction. Unless this happens, the outcome of a transaction may be erroneous. Okay, here in this case, the logs are to be acquired for the shared data kind of thing will have to be done. Okay, like suppose there are two users who are performing the transaction on the same data item, like they are purchasing something. They are purchasing something, and so when they are purchasing, that time the number of items will be decreased. So one transaction should be independent of the other transaction, and it should not left your database in an inconsistent state. So the transactions are isolated. One transaction does not interfere with another transaction, and both should happen properly. Okay, means when two people are buying the same item at the same time, there are two transactions, and the transactions should be independent of each other, and still your database should work in a proper way. So this database manage RDBMS is designed in such a way that it will take care of this. We as a programmer, we are not doing anything for it. That but the RDBMS is designed in such a way that it is your database is always any transaction should be atomic, consistent, isolated, and durable. Durable means when the transaction is completed, the effect of modification performed by the transaction must be permanent in the system. So it should be persistent. It should be persistent. Durable is another way is persistent data, where it is permanently stored inside the system. So whenever you restart or whenever you access after some time, you can retrieve the copy or modification. You get the modification effect. Okay, done previously. You are doing some modifications after some time. If you are accessing, you should get the effects of the modification done before. Or if you restart your system, then you start from when the transaction is over. Okay, so these are, I think you are aware of these four properties. So I what we want to remember is that your RDBMS ka transaction have all these four properties. It should follow all these properties. So classical relational database follow LCID properties. Now we'll see like in the distributed system scenario. Okay, so this was about the RDBMS, like what is RDBMS? A relational database management system, then structured data, transactions, SCID rules are there, and joins are there. Okay, outer query, nested query, nested outer join, nested query, all these things are there in RDBMS and it is suitable for transactions. And then at the same time, parallelly, like we study about distributed system, people are going towards distributed systems. Like the best example is cloud computing. Cloud computing mein everything is distributed. Or your IoT, if it is installed, and if IoT systems are started, will start working, it is a distributed system ka example. Internet is the best example of distributed system, where all the web documents are stored at different data web servers. Okay, in case of websites or internet ka web, okay, web, world wide web is the application of internet. Internet is different and world wide web is different. Internet is gives you the infrastructure where the machines are connected to each other, and world wide web is the application, which is a distributed system running on the top of internet. So in case of world wide web, and this is the best example of distributed system where your web documents are distributed. Okay, so in this case, so everywhere now we see that the systems are changing. Previously we were having a client server kind of architecture, and within the organization we were having a server and client machines connected to each other. Nowadays it is a distributed system architecture. So we need to know like what is distributed system and what are the advantages, also to understand why there is a need of NoSQL. Okay, so that's why this is a slide. So in case of distributed system, there are multiple computers or multiple software components. So multiple computers connected via computer network, it can be a network of internet or it can be a wide area network dedicated network. Okay, so in distributed system, multiple computers are connected using networking, and multiple software components can also be running in a distributed fashion on these machines. Okay, so means we are saying that we are using multiple machines, and the machines may have different configurations, such as mainframe hai, personal computer hai, workstation hai, different operating systems are there. So heterogeneous machines connected using a computer network such as internet or wide area network. So a distributed system consists of multiple computers connected. And your program is also written in such a way that it is having multiple software components, and the components are distributed. Okay, so we are not keeping our program at only one location. We may write a program in such a way that some components are residing at some location, some components are residing at some other location. I think you are aware of the meaning of the software component. Okay, just to elaborate, initially we were writing a standalone application, like in the first year or second year, what you write is a standalone application where you're writing a single main program. Okay, then people started writing and it was a procedure oriented approach. If it is a single program with functions, it is a procedure oriented approach. Then people started working for object oriented programming, where they are writing the program in the form of classes and objects. The next version of or advanced version of object-oriented programming is component-oriented programming. So we are creating the component-oriented components. Like suppose the organization is always working towards some multiple applications. So they will have a login component created, and the same component can be used in multiple applications. So it is the advantage of software component is reusability. So you write a component, the component has the interfaces, standard interfaces, and through the interfaces the communication is happening. So suppose I want to use a particular ready-made component, like a login component or a particular security component, then I just need to see the interfaces to invoke the functionality of the component. So it is similar to the hardware component, such as our plug and socket, electric socket, where or USB. So there the interface is standard through which our pen drive is connected to the machine. So that interface is something which tells you how to communicate with that particular component. So this .NET technology got invented, and this Java bins, enterprise Java bins and .NET, that programming is the component oriented programming, where we create a component which is a ASP.NET component which follows the standards of interfaces provided by ASP.NET. Or if we are using enterprise Java bins component, that component follows will have the interfaces which follows the standard interfaces specified by EJB. Okay, so these are the components. People are nowadays writing their applications in the form of components, and their application is plug and play architecture, where all these components are plugged together with each other and use them and call the functionality, and your application is ready. Okay, so what we are trying to achieve here is that we don't want to write each and everything again and again. Every application, every project, same kind of code. Why to rewrite? So create a component, use the component, plug and play, and your application will be ready. Okay, so once a component is created for one project, it should be reusable to another project. Okay, so in real world, because I have worked in the industry, I know that there is a server where people, once the component is created, they keep that component, ready made component, in the library of components. And if anyone is using any programming, then if that functionality is needed, he can take that component from the library of components and reuse in the system. So like this is why I am explaining you this, because this is a change in the programming happening in the real world, that we have to write a distributed kind of application, where we are writing our application in the form of components and they are distributed across multiple computers. Okay, so the computers are interacting with each other. Even the purpose is to share the resources. Okay, purpose is to share the resources also to achieve the common goal. And so these are the advantages. Like distributed system advantages, or we say that it should. If you are writing your own distributed system, then you need to keep in mind all these features that should be there for any distributed computing application. Like reliability, it should be reliable, because the components are, or your data is distributed, the system should be reliable. If the machine is failed, the data should be accessible, and it should not be affect the running of the other part of your system. It should be available 24/7. So it, and the data should be reliable data, and the system should cover up itself for any crash. Address of the system should not be affected. That is reliability. So you should rely on that particular system. And scalability means it should be easily expanded by adding more machines. So here, with respect to software also, if it is in the form of components, you can easily scale your application. You can easily go on changing your application. Today, with respect to today's requirement, you build the application. Tomorrow, if there is any new requirement, you should not have to rewrite the entire application again. It will be like a component architecture, so just insert new component or delete some of the components, and easily you scale your system. So that is with respect to software. With respect to hardware, it should be easily expanded by more machines. If the load is increased, you add new machines, and it should be handled by new computers. That is the requirement for distributed applications. Then sharing of resources is also. It should be able to allow you to share the resources, such as in banking or reservation systems, the data is shared. And even resources you want to share, like printers for distributed system, hardware resources, software resources. System should be flexible. It should be easy to implement or debug new services. The speed should be high. Okay, speed of the computing should be high. It should not be very slow. It should be open system. Okay, the interfaces should be clearly defined so that anyone can use it, and it should perform well. Okay, because of the distributed architecture, it should not happen that you fired the query and it's giving you lot longer time to see the output. It should similar to the normal centralized system. Okay, so this is just to give you the overview of the current type of applications which are happening in the real world right now. Okay, so previously when RDBMS was becoming very famous, most of the time it was three-tier architecture or it was a centralized system. So nowadays we are writing distributed applications. Our computers are also distributed because of the advancement of computer networking, and it should have all these features. Okay, so in that case, but what are the challenges rather than disadvantages? I can say the challenges in this particular architecture is that troubleshooting and diagnosing any problem in case of any failure, like where exactly the failure is there in that distributed system, that we don't know. Then less software support. It's very difficult to write the programs for a distributed architecture, and the less software support is there. So there is a need of having proper tools. Then networking may, there are so many problems can happen, that transmission, overloaded network, or loss of messages. So we have to handle all these challenges, and should be secure also, because the data is going via networking. It is a less secure. So apply multiple techniques of security. These are the challenges of distributed computing. Okay. So in that case, like, there was no option that if you want to store your data in a distributed fashion, there was a need to have such kind of databases called as NoSQL databases. Okay. This slide just shows you the difference between RDBMS and NoSQL. But it is at high levels difference. Okay, it is not in very depth. But initially, I cannot tell you all the differences at the same time. So these are few differences which you keep in mind when I am going through the remaining slides. Okay. So what this slide is saying is that this relational database management system, your database is relational. Here it's the name is relational database management system. NoSQL may. NoSQL means that it is not only SQL. It is not only SQL, but other than that also. Okay, so that's why the name is not only SQL. It is, you don't only fire SQL commands, but you can have something else other than that. It's the meaning of NoSQL. And in case of RDBMS, your data is structured and organized, but here your data can be unstructured, semi-structured, and unpredictable. There is no guarantee what will be there inside the data. First record may have something, the another record may have some other data. So every row may have some different kinds of information. There is no fixed structure, and the data is unstructured. Okay, and if it is an image or video data, then or text data, text file, then there is no proper structure, and it is not written in a rows and columns format. In case of RDBMS, these are the examples, like Oracle, MySQL, which may provide you high consistency for RDBMS. Data is following ACID properties, so it is highly consistent. It follows all four properties. Okay, but in case of this NoSQL, the types are key value, column store, document store, and graph. These are main four categories as per the syllabus we are studying. Key value database, column store, document store, and graph store. And I'll again repeat, key value means Amazon's DynamoDB, column store means HBase, document store means MongoDB, and graph databases means Neo4j. Okay, so it prioritizes the high performance, high availability, and scalability. So here the focus is not on this ACID property. The focus is morely on high performance, faster computation, available all the time, and scalability. This is very, very important in this case. Okay, scaling RDBMS is difficult. Scalability, achieving scalability in RDBMS is very difficult. Once you have decided a powerful database server today, tomorrow if you want to upgrade it, it's difficult. It's not that easy. Scaling of your database server is not that easy. But here it is highly scalable. Like, easily anytime you can scale your system. Okay, so here in case of RDBMS, we are having the languages such as data definition language, data manipulation language and you fire the SQL queries by using SQL language. But here there is no such query language for NoSQL databases. So it is a little difficult. You have to write a program for that to access the data. So you maybe you will be provided with APIs and you will have to write down a Java program to access the data or Python program to access the data. So not or some other tools. But so it is not a declarative query language. So no query language. In RDBMS, your data and relationships are stored in separate tables. Like you have metadata tables. For employee table, you have a metadata table of employee which tells you about the structure of your data. Database ka table employee. Like so metadata information. So data and even relationships are stored in separate tables. Relationship between two tables. But here there is no predefined schema or no such kind of relations are stored anywhere. Okay, so here it is SCID properties are followed, but here SCID is not there. So if SCID is not there, then something is there, which is called as a base transaction or CAP theorem. So we'll see this, what is CAP theorem in the next slides, previous. And then here the type consistency is there, here the eventual consistency is there. So what is meant by that? Type consistency means that whenever the data is here, the data may be replicated. So whenever there is any or if any transaction is happening, even if it is not replicated, whenever any transaction is happening, immediately within the fractions of seconds, the data is in the consistent state, and the same view of the data is there for all the users. All the users, when they are looking or they are performing any view operation, there is a tight consistency. And if any modification is done, immediately they are looking at the model. They will get a fresh copy. So tight consistency is there, but here it is not possible to have the tight consistency. So maybe your data is not that consistent compared to RDBMS because it is distributed across multiple computers. So, but there is eventual consistency. Eventual consistency means that eventually after some time, some time gap or within some days or within some months, all the data will go into the consistent state. Okay, so eventual consistency is there. So today you are modifying something and eventually everything will become slowly with time in a consistent manner, not within the fractions. That is called as eventual consistency. Okay, so any doubt in this?
No.
Okay. So these are the high level differences. Like when we are learning about NoSQL, we should know that your RDBMS is having SQL, DDL languages which are not there here. It is highly consistent RDBMS mein. Here eventual consistency is there. यहाँ पे SCID है, वहाँ पे SCID is not there, but something is there that is called as CAP. Okay, so scalability के लिए we are saying that NoSQL databases are highly scalable. So they are designed in such a way that the system should be scalable because the big data is going to increase continuously. The size of the data is continuously increasing, and as I told you that today's big data may be a small data tomorrow. So the system should be scalable. It should be able to handle the load as the big data size is increasing. The system should also be able to handle the data size. So it is designed by keeping in mind about the scalability. But here, in case of relational database management, that time they never thought about it. So how the scalability is to be achieved? Okay, and what is scalability? So for that, this particular slide is there. So whenever you want to build any scalability kind of operations in your system, you can either go for vertical scaling or horizontal scaling. Okay, so there are two ways of scaling: horizontal scaling and vertical scaling. So this diagram shows you vertical scaling, and this another right hand side diagram shows you horizontal scaling. And scalability means the ability of a system to expand to meet your business needs. Suppose your business needs are there, and you want to expand your system. Your system should be scalable. You should be able to handle. Like scaling web application to allow more people to use your application. For example, suppose today to your website may you are handling the traffic of average users at the same time, such as suppose millions of users accessing the site at the same time. Okay, and suddenly if there is any scheme or something happens because of some event, suddenly the traffic increases and each and everyone is accessing that particular information on your website. So all the people all over the world is accessing your website, and the load is suddenly increased. So for that particular amount of time, your system should be able to handle that load, and then so it should be like elastic. If the load is there, it should be able to handle it, and if the load is less, it will reduce the resources needed. But it should be scalable system, okay? And you can scale the system by upgrading your extra hardware sometimes. Okay, so extra hardware. Suppose it is RDBMS system, then it is always done with the help of vertical scaling most of the time. So vertical scaling means today you are having two CPUs, 1 GB RAM, 20 GB disk, and you are able to handle the current load. And now you understand that there is a you have to scale up the system, then you may go for 4 CPUs, 2 GB RAM, 40 GB hard disk, and you replace your machine. So you are adding some other CPUs instead of two, you are using 4 CPUs, increasing the memory. This kind of scaling is called as vertical scaling. So RDBMS goes for vertical scaling. But for vertical scaling, there is a limit. Like you cannot go on increasing. Instead of CPU, you can go for GPU, graphical processing units, which are highly powerful machine, processors. But if that is there, they are also having some capacity or some limitation about some amount of RAM. Even if you are RAM is cheap nowadays compared to the previous days. So if you go on adding the RAM continuously, but your processor will not be able to access the entire RAM. It has its own capacity. Up to that only it can access the available memory. So it is not going to help you. But for RDBMS kind of database servers, you go for vertical scaling and you will increase the capacity of your database server. That way you do the scaling. But in case of NoSQL databases, this horizontal scaling is there. So that is called a scale out. For vertical scaling, the another term that is used is scale up, scaling up. That is vertically scaling. And this is a horizontal scaling, means scale out. So what we do in this horizontal scaling is that today you are having two CPUs, 1 GB RAM and 20 GB RAM, and the load is there with the system. So what you do that you add one more machine similar with the similar configuration. So here you are having another machine, so total with 4 CPU, 4 GB RAM, or 2 GB RAM, or 40 GB hard disk. Like this, you add another machine of the same capacity. So here the machine may not be that expensive, but here this 4 CPU and 40 GB hard disk or 2 GB RAM का जो मशीन है, that may be costly, very costly, because it is a powerful server. So it will be costly. Here, what we do in the same capacity का machine, we are adding and horizontally scaling the. So the job which one machine was doing, so that job can be handled by two machines now. Okay. So NoSQL systems data store can be much faster as it takes the advantage of scaling out, which means that add another node to the system and distribute the load over the nodes. So this is about horizontal scaling. So this slide talks about the scaling, like scaling is needed depending on the need of the business. And there are two types of scalings: vertical scaling, horizontal scaling. Vertical scaling type of mechanism is used in case of RDBMS, and horizontal scaling of mechanism is used in case of NoSQL kind of databases. Okay. So now we are going towards what is exactly NoSQL. Okay. So this was the background, like why there was a need, and people then started thinking about it, and they came up with NoSQL databases. It is called as a non-relational database management system. So, okay, now, so listen carefully. We are talking about the features of NoSQL databases. Okay, right now, for the last 10 minutes of the lecture, we are concentrating on the NoSQL database ka features. NoSQL database is a non-relational database management system that is different from traditional RDBMS. Non-relational database systems, where we have a distributed data stores, a data store is distributed. For example, Google and Facebook, they collect the terabytes of data. So their data stores are multiple data stores, like a cluster. So data stores are distributed. And they are not having a fixed schema to store their information. The data which is stored does not have a fixed schema. They avoid the join operations and they typically scale horizontally. So it is a non-relational database management system where we are having distributed data stores because of terabytes of information, petabytes of information, which is not having, and the data which is there inside the data store is not having a fixed schema. We don't use the join operations, no joins, so no complex queries, writing only simple kind of query and simple kind of operations to perform analytics, and we scale horizontally. Okay, so the name is not only SQL. Okay, it is introduced by Carl and this Eric. First it was introduced by Carl in 1998, and then it is reintroduced by Eric. Okay, and the Eric says that you need to solve a problem. Why we are going for, or why we are inventing NoSQL? Because we need to solve a problem that relational database is not is bad fit for. Okay, the whole point of seeking alternative of this particular kind of databases is that you need to solve a problem that RDBMS is bad fit for. There are some problems which cannot be solved by RDBMS. So that's why NoSQL, which will solve the problems which are not solved by relational database management systems. So it is a database management system for storage of massive amount of unstructured data. It can store, it can retrieve. So it can perform write operation, it can perform read operation. And normally, as I said, we just do the write operation once and read operation for multiple times. Okay, so NoSQL database, and these are the examples in the diagram that Redis, MongoDB, HBase, Cassandra, then this Tokio, Membase, Neo4j, CouchDB, all these are the examples. So these are unstructured databases. We can store them and we can read them in a distributed fashion. Data store is distributed. It stores large volume of data about users, objects, and products. So it information, normally it is a data about the users, about the some objects, something, and some products. Okay, and it is a next generation database that is different than the traditional database. It is other than but the query language, other query languages can be used with NoSQL. The name is not only SQL, but some other query languages are used to work with this query NoSQL databases. Okay, we can provides a simple APIs. It provides a simple APIs. So by using the APIs, we can write a program, and through the program, by using this application programming interface libraries of this database, we can fire the query or get the data into your program. Okay, but sometimes we are having advanced tools such as Hive is a database. Uske liye we are having a tool called as HiveQL. To find which will give you the query languages, query language kind of statements to access the data from Hive, or if it is a pig kind of tool, then it is having a pig Latin as a scripting language to access the data. So it uses distributed architecture, and it can manage the massive amount of data, and it can be implemented on commodity hardware. Okay, that has separate RAM and disk. So the key features are: it is non-relational, it doesn't require fixed schema, or it is free from join operations. It is unstructured, non-relational, no fixed schema, no joins, and data is replicated, fault tolerant. Data can be partitioned so that there can be multiple partitions. So if one partition is inaccessible, the other partition is accessible. So in case of network failure, partition tolerance will help you, and still you can access the data. Horizontally scalable. It is very cheap. Most of the time, it is an open source. Okay, and fast access, because the access is mostly key value pair. Around 150, or it is a long back, they are saying 150. Today, though, it may be more than 150. NoSQL databases are available. Okay, so the disadvantages are: it doesn't fully support relational features. So jo relational mein hai, that is not available here, group by order. This complex queries are not possible because of no joins, or referential integrity constraints are not there across the partitions. No SQL language is not there. There is no SCID, no guarantee of your data. and integration know is the integration with other applications that support SQL. So if you want to integrate your application with another application which is having SQL data, then the integration is not easy. Okay, so these are the disadvantages. So I think that the time is over. Okay, so we can stop now here. Any doubts, you know, if you are having any doubts, please talk to me. There are only 27 students joined today. How many are in placements today? Can anyone tell me? See, this BE students, you are not replying and you are not talking to me.
Ma'am, we don't know. There are around 15 students are there. Around okay. 15 to 14 students are there for placements.
Okay. So placement is there, na? Today, I think so.
Yeah.
That's why. So any doubts, Silla? You understood na, today's lecture?
Yes, ma'am.
We created the background about the SQL database. SQL databases, yeah. We may require one more lecture to know about NoSQL, how it is handling the problems of big data. And okay. Then we will start with the case studies. Okay. So I may okay. be I may be devoting 4 to 5 lectures on this particular chapter.
Okay.
Okay. And I'll post the assignments today that you do it in this weekend, yes. Saturday, Sunday. Okay. So see you. Bye.
Thank you.